Now let's take a look at memory diagrams to explain how passing by value works for primitive data. The first thing you need to know is the difference between arguments and parameters. When you call, which means use, a method, the arguments are the raw materials that are used to calculate the result. So for example, I can call the math.abs function. Abs stands for absolute value, with an argument of -7, and it will return a 7. On the other hand, I could have called it with a math.abs of 7, so the argument there is 7. And it will also return 7 because the absolute value of both -7 and 7 is in fact 7. Parameters are different though. When you write a method, parameters are variables that will be assigned values from the arguments. So the parameters are fakes. They're just standing in for the arguments. We have to have a name because we don't know what argument is going to be passed in when we write the method. They only live as long as the method lives, so they have a very, very short lifespan usually. Now the parameter names are actually irrelevant. You could call them anything. But of course we always try to give our parameters meaningful names because it makes it easier for people to read the code. Local variables are similar to parameters, but they're a little bit different because the parameters get initialized, that is given values, from the arguments, whereas local variables don't. Now here's the big question. Do parameters change arguments? Well, it turns out that depends on several factors. First is the type of parameter. So the answer is different for primitive data types and objects. So primitive data types, which is what we're looking at now, like int and double, work differently than objects like string and scanner. Now the reason they work differently is because they're stored in memory differently. What's more, when we start talking about objects, it makes a difference where the object was constructed, whether it was constructed inside the method or not. We'll handle this in the next section of the class. It turns out that memory diagrams are a perfect way to answer these questions, so this is a good chance for you to see the advantages of learning this way of visualizing what's happening inside a computer. So a memory diagram is a way of visualizing how programs work. Basically, it shows how the memory is allocated in the computer. This is something that's very abstract, and so it can be hard for people to understand it. By drawing a picture of it in a consistent and correct way, it helps you to really understand how computer memory is working. It's also an incredibly important debugging technique. When you get into a really bad situation with a computer program, drawing a memory diagram is one of the ways of understanding what it's doing. Let's talk a little bit about primitive data types. When we say int size is 3 or double length equals 2.7, each variable is going to get a box. The name of the variable is on top and the contents of the box is the value. So you can see we've got size, it has its own box, and the value is 3 because that's how we assigned it. Length, on the other hand, is a double and its value is 2.7. So this is how you draw primitive data types. Now here's the code we're going to trace. So let's read it first and try to make sense of what it's trying to do, and then see if it's actually successful in doing it. Now remember, we could have answered this question by just running the program. But the problem with running the program is while it will tell you whether it's doing the correct thing or not, it won't really offer you an explanation of what's going on, so you won't really understand it. And if you don't understand it, then you won't be able to write the code correctly. So here we've got public class example, and we've got our main program. It's always a good idea to read the main program first because that's where the action is. That's where things get started. So we've got two variables called x and y, and they're given values of 0 and 7 respectively. And then we call this method that does a swap. And it takes x and y, and we see if we look at the method that it takes the first value. Now notice the names have changed here. So the 0 from x is going to be passed into a as the value for the parameter a. The 7 from the argument y is going to be passed to b is the value for the parameter b. Now the reason they get passed in that order is because Java uses order to determine which one is where. So the first argument goes to the first parameter, and the second argument goes to the second parameter. A is assigned to a location temp. Temp is a local variable, so it isn't going to live very long. Then A gets assigned B's value, and B gets assigned temp's value. Well, you probably recognize that code because you've written it in Turing's craft several different ways. So that really does look like a swap. So from what we know at this point, it seems like that method should work just fine. Here's some instructions for tracing code. You always start at the main program, because like I said a few minutes ago, that's where the action is. And you create something called the main stack frame. What that is the area where all of the variables that are local variables in the main program are stored. Then you execute the program one line at a time. As you encounter methods, you go to them. You create a stack frame for each method. You copy the arguments into the parameters, and a lot of people forget to do that. Then you complete the execution of the method and return to the main program. Now remember, a main program can and often does have more than one method in it. For right now, we're just going to worry about one method. Once we've completed the execution of the main program, the program stops working, and so at that point we can see what's happened. Now let's trace some code. So we go to the main program, and we see there's int x equals 5. So we create our main stack frame, and we create a location called x, and we put 5 in it. Then we say int y equals 7. So there we create a location called y, and we put the value 7 in it. Now we're getting ready to swap x and y. We create the stack frame for swap and put the locations a and b in it. The value of the arguments x and y, 5 and 7, get passed to the parameters a and b and are stored in the right location. Now we've got our local variable temp, and it gets assigned the value that's in A, so it gets the value of 5. Now A gets the value of B, so the 5 is gone, and then B gets the value of temp, so B gets the value of 5. So we can see that A and B were successfully swapped. But wait a minute, what happened to X and Y? Well, our method is through now. So at that point, the swap stack frame actually goes away. Now, I'm not going to cross that out or anything like that because it makes it hard to read this. But what we see is once swap is finished, nothing got assigned to X and Y in the main program. And so X and Y didn't get swapped. Oh, that's a problem. Essentially, our program didn't work. Well, what does this mean? Well, it means the method didn't do what it was supposed to do. It turns out that swap cannot be done in Java. Not this way. This is because primitive data types are passed by value. Now, I have to admit, when I was first learning to program, I found this concept really confusing. But the idea shows up very well in a memory diagram. When the values in X and Y were copied to locations A and B, we created a separate copy. Anything we do with A and B isn't going to impact X and Y one little bit because they're at a different place in memory. They're in a different stack frame. So changing the data in A and B had absolutely no impact whatsoever on X and Y. And that is what passing by value means. So the moral of this story is it is impossible to change a primitive data type value inside a method. So keep programming.